So good morning, everybody. I think we'll get started. The first and most important announcement, if you hear nothing else this morning, please hear that there are fresh bagels to my right on the side of the room.
The best bagels that have ever bagel to bagel.
Graciously provided by our panel, so feel free to get up and help yourselves through the morning. So my name is Megan Richardson, and I'm Chief of Education and Public Programs at the National Gallery of Canada in Ottawa, just a couple hours away. A couple of housekeeping things first. For those of you who'd like to tweet about this session, we've come up with the hashtag MuseumLabMeetup, so tweet away. And the session this morning is divided kind of into three parts. Each speaker, we have Dawn first, and then our three colleagues comprise the second group. Each gang will have about 20 minutes to speak, and there will be time for questions at the end. So rather than break the flow, we'll hear all four or all two presentations, depending on how you do the math, and we'll have questions at the end of the morning. So Don Undine is the senior manager of the Media Lab at the Metropolitan Museum of Art, and when he's not delighting people with his hyper-creative Ignite-style performances and squiring the digital humanities unicorn around town, who is joining us this morning and looking a little hungover, Don has done everything from programming shopping carts in JavaScript at a mom-and-pop internet service provider to working for the Children's Oncology Group and spam companies. He's the co-founder with Coven Smith, who joins us this morning, in the 1990s of a 35-member musical collective, and is currently applying that experience to developing a community of creative technologists to work on diverse projects exploring the intersection of modern technology and traditional culture. The project Don is going to speak about this morning, the New York City Museum Media Lab Meetup, is one such project. Justine Chapleau is an art history and anthropology grad from the Université de Montréal and the Sorbonne in Paris. She's currently working on her master's degree in museum studies at the Université de Montréal, Université du Québec à Montréal, long titles here, specializing in the use and mediation of new technologies in art and culture. She's the co-founder with Mélissa Trottier of, to her left, or to her right rather, of Project X, a community, Projet X, I should say, a community and participatory project developed by a group of grad students at the universities. Mélissa Trottier has degrees in social anthropology from the Université de Montréal and a certificate in arts heritage from the Maastricht University in the Netherlands. She's an MA candidate in museum studies at the Université de Montréal and is passionate about community engagement and interaction within the museum. Justine and Mélissa are joined today by Pierre Tanguy, a professional with 12 years of experience in various areas of arts management, including strategic planning, partnerships, financing, international co-production, and touring. A decade-long collaboration with artist Linda Gaudreau has led to numerous projects in a dozen countries on four continents, with partners like the Venice Biennale, the Théâtre de la Ville de Paris, and the Architectural Association in London. He also worked for 4 years at the National Film Board of Canada. Pierre is also pursuing graduate studies in museology at the Université du Québec à Montréal, where his main interests relate to organizational culture and strategic management in the museum and contemporary art sectors. Justine, Mélissa, and Pierre will speak this morning about Projet X, Project X. And while there are no actual links between the two case studies that make up this session, Justine was kind enough to share with me the story of how she and Don spent a wonderful day together in New York last April talking about new technologies, museum participation, and the challenges of changing the mentality of museums and apparently of cats. So without further ado, I'll turn it over to Don Undine. Thanks for being here.
Okay, hey everybody. Thanks for waking up at 9 in the morning. We got bagels for you. Help yourself. I talk pretty loud, so you're getting bagels isn't going to bother me. So what I'm going to talk about today is this thing that we started called the New York City Museum Media Lab Meetup Group. I'm going to talk about sort of why we decided that it was a good idea to make something like that, what we sort of learned from the process of doing it. And I mean, the idea is that you guys can come out of this with some sort of idea of things you might be able to do in your own museum, in your own communities. And we can talk maybe a little bit about what about this model might work or might not work in your particular institutions. So I submitted this, proposal, I guess, a handful of months ago, right? So we just started doing this meetup group. That was about 7 months ago when we started it. 7 months ago was a long time, right? It was a different world, right? I mean, man just lands on the moon. Young Joe Piscopo was making us laugh. It was a different time. And we were trying to figure out what as an institution can we do to sort of engage the museum community. To step back even farther into the prehistory, the Met had done a 3D hackathon about two-ish years ago. We invited as our first sort of foray into working with the creative technology community in New York City. It was really inspiring. We brought a lot of people into the museum who didn't think about interacting with our collection in this way. We realized that there was a lot of energy, a lot of creative potential in bringing together traditional museum institutions and people and expertise in the collection with creative technologists in our city. But we're like, okay, well, how do we build on this? So the Media Lab was sort of founded at this intersection between museums and creative technologists. And that in the middle of that, we can build up some sort of community that intersects culture and inspiration to push forward interesting projects, right? And we were still trying to figure out what's the right way to do this. For those of you who aren't familiar with meetup.com, meetup.com is a website basically for finding and organizing communities of interest. There's meetups about just about everything, right? There's singles meetups, meat lovers meetups, you know, art meetups, sports meetups, just about anything you want. It's just a really convenient site for organizing people to get together in real life. Meetups can take a lot of different formats. Sometimes people just sit and listen to a presentation, kind of like this. Sometimes people get together just for networking because they know everybody in this room is really interested in the same thing. We can make some interesting stuff happen if we just talk to each other. Sometimes they just get together and get hammered. They'll go on field trips, right? The organizer of a meetup group might bring everybody to some business or site and for some sort of activity. Or they'll do workshops where they actually get to get hands-on with things. So we were looking at all, you know, I'm a sort of a meetup junkie. I'm a member of like hundreds of different meetup groups in New York. New York has a really big meetup community. Just a show of hands, has anybody used Meetup or is familiar with it? How many people in the room are actually like do stuff on Meetup? Okay, cool, awesome. So this is not that weird. So this is the MCN word cloud. I'm sort of an MCN baby in a lot of ways. MCN has sort of made me the man that I am today, for better or for worse. And so I was just sort of pulling, these are just sort of the kinds of ideas that keep coming up in MCN, right? This idea of there are new forms of engagement, having a playful museum, lots of diverse voices, community engagement, the museum as a forum, right? All these ideas are sort of breaking down the walls of museum broadcasting authoritative information to the people and people being more engaged with the collection in new and different ways. Ways that we as museum people don't necessarily can't predict, right? So we started thinking about, well, if we wanted to really do community engagement in the Met, what are our primary, you know, priorities and principles? I have so many like slides with text today, I'm really embarrassed. Usually there would be pictures of cats here, but I didn't know how to do a cat slide for priorities and principles. But basically, we wanted to somehow create this sort of dynamic community that was like hands-on, you know, that the people involved in the community were the ones doing. Sorry. So we wanted the people who were like in the community to be driving it, not the museum saying, here's the things we're going to do, and you can get involved if you want. But we really wanted to put as much control in the hands of the members as possible. We wanted the museum to sort of sit there and act as a resource provider and give people what they needed. We wanted it not to be just the Met. We wanted to have lots of sharing. We didn't want to get caught up with the vendors trying to market stuff to us, which is definitely a trick. And we wanted to make sure that everybody coming to these meetups, it wasn't like a networking meetup or just sitting and listening to a presentation, that everybody was there to get engaged and do stuff. So that was sort of what we wanted to make happen. And when I submitted this proposal, I wasn't sure if we were going to do this the right way. And I'm still not sure if we're doing it the right way. But this is where we're at. So we founded the New York City Museum Media Lab Meetup. We had an awesome community development intern, Dee Dee, who made our kick-ass logo, the unicorn with a rainbow horn. All of our members are called unicorns because creative technologist and museum enthusiast is really too long. So let me switch to the video because this is awesome. So Dee Dee made this awesome video about the meetup group. Let's see if it's... Yeah. production value on this. Could be that this is just like a template in iMovie, but I'm gonna go with this. All I've done. And a dry eye in the house.
A lot more breakout work, a lot of people getting together to actually sort of create a mini hackathon, which is the way that Don described it the first time that we got together. And I think that's just going to be really important for the next few meetings.
And you can basically, as you're typing, you can grab an image from the collection to add to help you express. So it's kind of like a more sophisticated adult emoticon.
Oh, nice. So some of the images obviously won't correspond to their locations. Mm-hmm. Per se, because mm-hmm. it's apples and oranges, but still, like, just showing the gallery would be...
That's so cute.
When you mouse over, it shows the corresponding images, and then also highlights...
Oh, and it shows you the other ones. Yes.
We could get all of the points from that mesh, right? Including, right. We could identify the smile, if you're still
interested. If I could start walking in that direction, it'll match it.
Humanity's person.
You want to tell this story because you had this crazy experience and you need to share it with someone. Like, you just have to tell someone right then and there.
First take it.
Yeah. I'll see if there's anything, like, obvious. So, like,
I've become really interested in the way that museums and cultural institutions like libraries and archives can work with creative technologists and artists and designers to help explore new models of interaction with our collections. Those kinds of projects will be inspiring for others and help us all find new ways to talk about what, you know, I call our shared cultural heritage. The kind of stuff that we've got in libraries, in art museums, belongs to all of us, and it's all expression of our history as human beings. And I think helping new people engage with that is what we're here to do.
Oh, you guys are still here. thank you very much. So the thing about everything you saw there, like, you know, no one was making a dime from showing up to any of those things. No one was trying to build a product to sell it to a museum. They are really coming because they think that the collection is cool, and they wanted to do neat stuff with it. And they seemed to be excited that a museum like the Met was interested in meeting them where they're at. So that was it's been really inspiring to me just watching this happen. As far as like the practical aspects of sort of how do we pull this together, practically speaking, we did definitely like vetted our applicants. I don't know if you guys use meetups, a lot of meetups, you just sort of anybody can join. We sort of ask a series of questions saying, seriously, are you really wanna like come and get involved and do stuff? Because if you don't, then we won't even, like, I've definitely denied plenty of members who just said, oh, I have this product I want to sell, or I want to, you know, I want to network and get a job. we would just, like, not let them join. And that's a little bit different than a lot of meetups. But basically the way we structured it to start out, you saw some of this in the video, we had a big whiteboard. We had the first three meetups at the Guggenheim, because they generously donated space for us to have the meetups, and they had a big whiteboard in one of their rooms. So on one side of the whiteboard, all the unicorns were writing down all the things that they are interested in, right? What their skill sets are. We had lots of creative coders and 3D modelers and designers, UX experts, a real variety of people. And they all wrote their skills and their names and on the board there. And then on the left-hand side, all the galleries, libraries, archives, and museums who came wrote down sort of what their collection is about, the kinds of resources that they think would be interesting and useful to to the unicorns. And in the middle, people just started writing down ideas for projects, just sort of brainstorming these things. And if people liked the idea, then they would write their name next to it and what their skills were, or we would write down, okay, well, this project's gonna need an API or a data set, or this project's really gonna need a database guy to help pull it all together, and people would put their names down. Then we photographed all of this stuff and used the meetup discussion board to sort of start to push these projects forward. So the idea was that we would sort of loosely project manage this stuff, let the creative, let the unicorns themselves sort of push things forward and let their own initiative drive forward what kinds of resources we were giving them. So we thought, okay, well, let's just turn and start making stuff, right? Let's just like have the next meetup and we're gonna start making things. So we had the next meetup, and you know there were some new people there. I would say maybe 50% new people, and no one knew how to start making anything yet, right? So we had this sort of fantasy in our head that we would just like sit down and just make, right? It didn't really work like that. We did like review all the old project ideas, and people would talk about it more. So we sat around and discussed these ideas, fleshed them out a bit. We noticed that some of the ideas were really concrete, like this is the thing I want to do and you just need to give me this data and I can do it. A lot of ideas were really vague, like I want to do something that helps people tell stories in the museum. I'm like, okay, well that's really interesting. There was a group of people that wanted to do it, don't really know what that means. So there's a lot more talking. We said, okay, well the third meetup we're definitely gonna start making things, and this is where it's gonna all kick off. Third meetup, I didn't take any pictures. So, yeah, I know, right? So this is an important lesson for this stuff is really like document these things, because once it's happened and you haven't taken any pictures, it didn't really happen, right? Pixar, it didn't happen. So third meetup was, what did we do? See, I didn't take pictures, so I don't remember. Oh, yeah, Jonathan started hacking on his on some stuff. We had some activities planned. But still, it felt like, okay, well, we're still just sort of showing stuff, and people aren't really getting engaged yet. And then the fourth meetup we had at ITP, which is a local part of NYU. It's basically a creative technology school, so we can solder there and build things. I ran a design thinking workshop because I was thinking that, you know, we've had these sort of vague project ideas. How do we gel them into something that can actually move forward, that people will have a shared vision for? So we did some design thinking workshops around storytelling, which is design thinking. The design thinking process as Stanford Design School created is basically sort of a program, series of steps you do where you ideate with somebody and you draw things and you make arts and crafts, and it helps people to coalesce around ideas. And Jonathan also was working on his project to digitally recreate Super Mario Clouds, which is this contemporary art piece. But again, like we were doing some stuff, but it didn't feel right. Like it didn't seem like we were getting the sort of dynamic magic that I wanted to have happen. One exception to that is this work that Michael Thompson there in the middle started working on. It's this piece called Smiles. And this to me is a really great example of the connection, how the connection between museum stuff and the unicorns can really make some really neat things happen that actually move forward into something kind of real. So Michael Thompson took it on himself. He started checking out the Met's website, and he came across this piece on our website. We have a section of our website called Connections where museum staff just share things that are interesting to them. One of our educators, Kathy Galitz, talked about smiles in art. And Michael Thompson thought that was really interesting, was really enchanted by Kathy. She's got an awesome smile. So what we did was we brought in Michael Thompson and a few other people who were interested to meet with Kathy. Kathy's not a meetup person. She's not like a digital media, you know, freakazoid like the rest of us. She just thought, wow, someone's interested in my thing, right? I talked about this, and now people who do stuff want to talk to me about it. Like, how awesome is that? So we brought them in the room together, and she just shared like what her perspective was on the history of smiles, a little bit of art history about history of dental work and things like that. And it really has changed painting a lot, actually, dentistry. Include Michael in onto this great book called A Brief History of the Smile. And Michael, he's an information visualizer, so he started building up these sort of charts and diagrams and taxonomies of how you might classify these things. And we had a handful of meetings, and it was all because like this guy and a few other people really thought smiles were interesting. They thought Kathy was cool. Kathy thought that these guys were cool because they thought that she was cool. Like they were And okay, this is the key actually, and this is really all you got to all that we had to do. And I've been building on this sort of model is you find somebody, a creative technologist, someone who likes to do things with the collection. You put them in a room with a person who knows about that stuff from the museum, and not necessarily like a digital person, and you just let them talk for a while. And what I found is now Michael Thompson is sort of vested in pleasing Kathy by giving her this thing that he makes and honoring the time that she spent with him. And Kathy honors the attention that she's getting by providing really interesting and useful feedback. And that was and that's sort of the magic sauce that I think that's making this meetup work now. And so we started to switch to, okay, every project that we look at in the meetup group, I say, okay, who can I get in the museum who will sit and talk with you for a while about your idea, and it not being really necessarily like a digital person who's trying to just make stuff happen like me. The other thing that really helped is that we sort of commandeered a physical space in the museum. Like being able to have a place that provides a sense of permanence to the group so they can come in every week, every month, and see that the projects they're working on are sort of represented. Where museum staff can come and see how projects are moving forward. They can see sort of demonstrations of things that people have done. I'm really sorry, hold up. I'm gonna pull that out. I'm getting messages from my mom or something. So we commandeered the space because the Big Chunga office had emptied itself, and we started moving tables in and computers. The other thing you need is pizza, right? So basically people will show up if you feed them. And that worked really well. Beer hasn't been as important as I thought it would be, which is good because it saves money. But yeah, physical space, creating conversation between curators and conservators and educators and creative tech and these unicorns, right, is what was making all this work. So being able to locate ourselves in the physical space of the museum mattered a lot. So we started doing inspiration walks, just like taking some tech. These are some fancy art-looking glasses that this vendor had sent me. So we would just walk around the museum trying out tech and exploring things. So that's been really a good way to... Sorry, I got that slide twice. Then we started doing tagathons. We brought a bunch of people together. I made an app that lets you identify locations of smiles in paintings, and we started to build up data sets. Provided a bit of pizza. We get like 12 or 15 people to show up for several hours on a Thursday, Friday night or a Saturday day, and they'll hang out with these people because they're sort of all vested in making this project work for the sake of Kathy. We've done some visits to other museums, sort of behind the scenes looks at modern making techniques. Started doing the hack days. A lot of the videos you saw was based around like hacking on the art. So all this stuff is basically, you know, really awesome creative technologists from some major universities in the area coming together just because they like this sort of thing. So all of this happened in one day, and just because people were interested in working with your collection. And one of the things I like to, when I speak, I like to tell people is that your collection is awesome and your people are awesome, and that's your core strength. And if you rely on, if you count on that, then you can get like amazing people outside of your museum to see that too. And they will do really amazing things because it's all of our shared heritage, right? So it's just awesome. So community is hard. Setting expectations is tricky. People want to know when they first join the meetup group, are you going to acquire my digital thing that I make? Are you going to buy it? Is it going to sit in a gallery so that other people can see it? And the answer to that is mostly no. You know, your place might be different, but you know, I can't promise people that this thing that you make is going to show up in a gallery, but we can put it online, we can blog about it, we can share about it in other ways, and let the energy of that push things forward. Figuring out how to delegate so that I'm not the only one running all of these things is tricky. Sometimes explaining what we do to the museum is hard. The most important thing is just making sure that everybody who comes, even if they can't contribute they can't contribute really technically, that their contribution is really valued and matters, and finding a way for everybody to fit in takes some work. Kick out the bad apples, people who don't show up, people who just talk and waste your time. Making it clear that this is a group about doing things is a real trick. And obviously, you know, no one likes jerks. So how do I make it work? And my point of view on it is the best way to make it work is to keep doing it, right? Just don't stop because the first handful of sessions aren't working out. don't make a big production out of everything. All of our meetups are like, you know, 10 to 20 people. Don't worry about whether a project means something in the sense of the museum. The point is that you're doing it and that people are willing to spend time doing what amounts to work for no money because they think it's awesome, and honoring that and trusting that that's going to lead to something great. It does help to seek out ringers. Like, if you know some real badasses, then court them, you know, and encourage them to come. So we're doing lots of different types of sessions, things you can do. You know, we realized that having these big sessions with a million projects all trying to run at the same time didn't really work. Like, brainstorming sessions are cool, but then have single-purpose sessions where a particular project does a particular kind of work for that session is a lot better than just, like, making everything a free-for-all. Hack days are great. Having workshops where you bring in people who are experts in tech to teach people how to do things, like do 3D modeling, but based around like practical projects that people want to execute on. Crowdsourcing is fun, and taking people behind the scenes. Anytime you can give a person who's outside the museum a chance sort of just to peek behind the curtain is a great way to build up loyalty and enthusiasm for what you're doing. So next up, right, figuring out how to take these meetups and the model of some of these kinds of meetups and make it a thing that you can expose the broader public to is definitely a thing that I'm looking at. Managing it all is definitely a trick. We still need to develop some sort of online management tools aside from meetup.com so that people can sort of gather resources. Finding someone to pay for all of the pizza is important. And of course, finding better ways to share with the museum as a whole, because we have a large museum and communication is hard. I'm sure you guys would have different ways of approaching that than we do. So is it worth it? I think if you make, you know, your institution a resource for a creative activity, if you trust that your collection is awesome, then people will do awesome things with your collection, because mostly people are pretty awesome. And remembering that those people could be at home watching TV, they could be with their kids, but instead they're abandoning their children to come hang out in a museum with other nerds, and that's awesome. So that's a really big deal. That's kind of all I got to say. I instead of like making my slides available, which I mean I could do, but I have a Tumblr, donandean.tumblr.com. It's called Unicorns Are Real, and I sort of put all my links and stuff there so you can like get access to all the things that I'm talking about. We have a GitHub account where we post all of our code for the different meetups that we've done. So so it concludes my presentation.
Okay, well, thank you for coming. As Megan mentioned, we're three grad students, and that's how we met and how we started working together. As Megan mentioned as well, we were going to talk about this toolbox that we developed, Project X, but it's a bit dry, it's like workflows and stuff like that. So we decided instead to talk to you about this experiment that we did called Variations with two other grad students who weren't here today. So we're going to tell you about that, and right before that, we're going to tell you a bit more about the people and the projects that inspire us. So I'll let Justin start.
Okay, so maybe as you know or don't know, when you study museum studies, you get this very, very ideal idea of the museum, how the museum should be and should not be, and like perfect text saying about the perfect museum. And we kind of didn't like that. So we decided to look around us what other people were saying about the museum, and basically that was mainly on the internet, on blogs. People were talking about their idea of the perfect museum, which was, well, a little bit more, a little bit funnier than what we were used to study. So we had Adam Lerner at the MCA Denver, who really got inspired. Mm-hmm. Julien Dora, French guy, who's creating creative community like Muséomix and Ars et Common. We had Nina Simon, who wrote the Participatory Museum book. We had Don, that I met last April for his birthday, and it was quite amazing. And those are the people that really got us inspired along the way. And since we're saying we love you to those people, we're going to say we love you to Charlotte and Aurélie, that they are the two grad students that did this project with us. And we wouldn't be here if there wasn't for their passion and time, and that's it. So we're going to talk to you about a little bit about different project that got us inspired now.
So the first project we're going to talk about is the Mixed Taste Conference Series that started at the lab at Belmar and is now hosted by MCA Denver. And it's basically the idea of taking two completely unrelated topics and juxtaposing them in a conference series, like pop art and pigeon racing, or zombies and raw milk cheese, and seeing what kind of discussions can come out of these pairings.
So we had this co-creation example where the National Museum of Scotland, they made some ghost objects of their collection and put a memory shed within the museum walls with a webcam, and people were allowed to take those ghost objects and go into the memory shed and share their memories about this object or how they would use it or how what kind of new purpose they could find to this object. And this really helped build the national history of this collection. So that was co-creation. And we also have...
This is another example of co-creation and history as well. It's a project developed by the History Center of Montreal. It's been going around for about 10 years, I think. It's called You're a Part of History, and it's basically targeted towards the kids of immigrant families and newly established families here in Montreal. And it's basically giving them a voice and allowing them to contribute their personal memories to the global history of the city. So that was an interesting example as well. And finally, this one at the City Museum of Stockholm, basically they gave history workshops to civil servants and people who work with the public in the city. So that way they created multipliers, and all these people who work in restaurants and parks, could actually disseminate the history of the city beyond museum walls. So
the idea of dialogue, of participation, and of really including the visitors within the museum are ideas that inspire us for our own project called Variations. And we're gonna start talking about that right now.
Variations was a cyber exhibition, and basically it started in one of our seminars. We were given the opportunity to develop a cyber exhibition, and rather than focus on the exhibition part, we're really interested in the cyber online part. So we started from there and developed a project based entirely on how people interact online and what kind of, and the tools they use online. It was also very experimental in the sense that we really didn't know what we were doing. So.
Yeah,
it was fun.
Mostly it was fun. We had tons and tons of fun doing it. It was rushed, but fun. So here are a few facts, ma'am.
So we had zero experience whatsoever building a website, creating a cyber exhibit, or an exhibit, period. But we just really wanted to start off with the idea of dialogue and really interacting with the visitors or the audience or the contributors. And in order to do that, we created two websites in the space of 3 months using very sophisticated tools such as Wix, Facebook, Gmail, and Flickr.
We were low tech,
yeah.
Right?
And we were 5 grad students working on this project. We were all working part-time, having full course loads, and it all cost $95. And in the end, it really worked. We had 269 submissions because the whole exhibit was crowdsourced. We had no collection whatsoever. We wanted people to contribute their artworks, their thoughts, their poems, whatever they felt like contributing. And this is what we got. So the first phase of the cyber exhibit was basically getting our collection because we started off with nothing. So we sent out a call to participation that was disseminated by different grassroots media around Montreal in the space of 2 weeks. So in 2 weeks, we had to do all of our publicity. People had to send in their artworks. And in order to help them or guide them through the process, we decided to use 3 trigger sentences, which were, "I'm not here right now, it's not important, and it reminds me of somebody." And the idea behind those trigger sentences was really to help funnel their creativity and just help them along the way.
And as Melissa mentioned, we got, in that very short 2 week period of time, 269 submissions from 59 unique contributors. As we were expecting, most of the contributions were photos, but a good quarter of them were actually text, poems, prose that people wrote. That was a very pleasant surprise. And remaining 15% with other types of contributions like paintings, drawings, collages. So there was a great diversity of contributions. And one of the trigger sentences that Melissa mentioned was much more popular than the other ones. half of the contributions came for "It reminds me of someone." That's probably because that trigger, that particular sentence triggers very personal memories. It's easier to relate to.
Okay, so we have our very own little hall of fame about this project. We received like overwhelmingly great comments like, "This is so cool, innovative project, good idea, good project, can't wait to see what other were inspired." And we did, we have to say, receive one bad comment, which basically was crap, well, "Pow pow, this is crap." So maybe this guy was on crack cocaine, or I don't know, but great, what? So we were really happy about it. I'm gonna show you some, a very few samples of the submission we received. We have, it's too bad you can't see it. Is there no, 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 okay, well, we'll tweet you the links and everything. So, what do we have to say? We were really amazed by the quality of the picture and poems and stuff we received. It was amazing. And we also have to say we were amazed by the generosity of our contributors, because they sent us so many things, so many great stuff, so many personal stuff. It was really amazing. So here's a picture of that you can't really see, but well, we had a series. We receive a lot of series, different series of photo, text, and stuff. A poem tag along with a picture, and other sample, which were more like a collage. Here, Sims playing volleyball on a Rothko. We had those drawings and this amazing mashup, hipster Neanderthal man stuff. So, can you talk about the creative license too?
So the second phase of the cyber exhibition was the production phase. So we did give ourselves 6 weeks to create a fully bilingual French and English exhibit in which we wanted to showcase the entire collection. And because everything was copyright free under the Creative Commons license, we really wanted people to play around with it and reappropriate the images that we were presenting on their website. And in order to get them started, we decided to do 4 curatorial rereadings. So we created our own exhibits showcasing different ways where you can use the exact same collection but with different meanings. We also wanted to do a behind the scenes look at the whole process, really open up the museum, make it transparent. So we had pictures of us doing the labs where we came up with the exhibits. We had a logbook with different resources about cyber art, about making an online exhibit, the web and pictures. And we also had a message board. We really wanted to be open, to foster a dialogue, and have people comment on what they saw and what they thought about our project. Another element that we wanted to implement, but we were technologically challenged, was we wanted to have visitors do a mashup of all of the artworks and the submissions that we got. So if anybody of you have the knowledge, we would like to talk to you about how to create that and make that happen.
We can offer bagels if you're interested. So I'm gonna show you a little bit this website of ours, if I can. Okay, good. So yeah, we built our website on Wix. It was quite a challenge, but I'm gonna show it to you anyway. So let's go to the English side. We really built this website as if you were in a museum. When you're in a museum, you have this like exhibition space and you have this behind the scene where you have offices with the great view and some in the basement and stuff like that. So we really built it so you could go in the exhibit or backstage. So I'm gonna start with backstage because you have to know how it worked before I show you what we've done. So basically you see what Melissa told you, we had process, logbook, message board, index, contact, and we had this, the collection that we put on Flickr. That was one of our main costs, just so you know. So here you have all these process photos, and when you went in album, you had our 3 main collection, which were separated by sentence, like, "I'm not here at the moment, it's not important, it reminds me of someone." So I'm gonna go in, "It's not important," and show you the kind of picture and text we receive. See how the quality is great, and people were really, they were happy to contribute, and we even received mat sheets and this amazing postcard saying, "My darling, beware of man, your mommy who loves you." And it's a scan of a real postcard that a person sent us. So basically that's it. You can go around. I'll send you the links. And then you could go to the exhibit. As we already told you, we did 4 re-readings according to different curatorial process. I'm gonna show you the second one that was very fun, but I just have to say that we did the 1, 2, and 4 that we did that, the five of us, and the third one, we asked 2 Montreal artists to curate it for us. So we sent them all the pictures and they did an exhibition with it. So, it's coming. So Mikeba, she's into creating a mind mapping. She started from a picture or an idea, word, something, and she mind maps around it, and she mind maps all kind of different media. So basically that's what we did. We had this huge submission table with the 269 submission, and we throw a pen on the table and it fall off on this very pretty picture, and we're really happy, so we kept it. And we built we built different unit of sense around it. So for non-Canadian, we had my shack in the wood part that was here. See all the, I mean, it's great stuff, right? Or you can see that with Hunt saying, "Wouldn't be a pleasure if you would make me supper." And we also made for each and every exhibition an about this exhibit, saying a little bit more about our process, what we think, how we think about it, and a few notes on the curator itself and his or her process. So that was a website we built with Wix. It was quite a challenge. So now I'm a Wix expert. If anyone needs it, I'm here. So here we go.
So the main idea behind our exhibit, and also the people who inspire us and the projects that we're interested in, all have to do with how to engage audiences. And it's something that we're really passionate about and that we want to continue exploring, and that's what we're all doing individually in our master's research, because we are still students. So Justine, what are you working on right now?
I'm working on conceptualizing the key principle around the participatory museum. So if you guys have any insight for me, or you want to talk to me, or you want to give me a great definition of a great principle, please come to me. Find me, tweet me, whatever.
And Pierre, what are you?
I'm working on the issue of intercultural dialogue in city museums. So I'm doing a comparative study on museums in Montreal, Antwerp, Ghent, and Rotterdam, in partnership with 2 universities here in Europe.
And I'm looking at participation and audience involvement in museums throughout the city through case studies. And this is something that we feel really passionate about, all three of us, and it's something that we wanted to continue exploring. And since we had so much fun doing the cyber exhibit, we wanted to keep having fun. So we took a leap of faith and we decided to create our own collective, if this is okay. Yeah. So we want to continue having fun around the city, around the world, and create new ways and experiment with culture and see how we could include the public into the museums or different cultural spaces, because we see it as an essential part of the future of museums.
And culture.
And culture.
So at the end, we just have to say our special thanks to Adéjari and Isabelle Guimont, who curated this one of the exhibition for us, to our 2 university who paid the fees for us to come here, yay, to the Collège Salette who shared their space with us in order to work, and to all our precious contributors that help us build this amazing exhibition.
So thank you.